Namaste, myself Mayuresh Raut, Assistant Professor in Department of Pharmaceutical Chemistry, Sinhagad Institute of Pharmaceutical Sciences, Lonavala. Today, we are going to discuss Hoffmann rearrangement. At the end of this topic, the learner should be able to understand what is Hoffmann rearrangement, the mechanism involved in Hoffmann rearrangement, the applications of Hoffmann rearrangement, and the stereochemistry involved in Hoffmann rearrangement. So what is Hoffmann rearrangement? In Hoffmann rearrangement, there is conversion of amides to amines by action of sodium hypohalite, which is usually generated in C2 by reaction of halogen and NaOH. In Hoffmann rearrangement, the product has one carbon atom less in the molecule than the original amide. Hoffmann rearrangement is an rearrangement of electron deficient nitrogen atom, wherein the rearrangement takes place on the electron deficient nitrogen. The general reaction of Hoffmann rearrangement is shown below, wherein the starting material is amide. It reacts with bromine and base, that is either NaOH or KOH, to give amine. Mechanism. Let us understand the stepwise mechanism which is involved in Hoffmann rearrangement. Step 1 involves abstraction of proton by a base to form intermediate 1. So the base, either NaOH or KOH, will dissociate to form Na plus and OH minus, and this OH minus will react with the amide, or it will abstract the proton of the amide and form intermediate 1, that is RCONH2 will be converted to RCONH. Step 2 is reaction of this intermediate 1 with bromine to form N-bromoamide. So the intermediate 1 reacts with the bromine to form N-bromoamide. The bromine gets attached to the nitrogen, so that's why it is called as N-bromoamide. Step 3 involves loss of proton from the N-bromoamide. So there will be loss of this proton and it will become RCONBr in step 3. Step 4, that is nothing but migration of the R group from the adjacent carbon atom to the nitrogen, leading to formation of isocyanate. In this case, the R can be either alkyl or aryl group. So you can see here the R group, it is migrating to the nitrogen atom, and at the same time bromine is leaving, leading to the formation of isocyanate. Step 5 is nothing but the hydrolysis of isocyanate to form carbamic acid. So the isocyanate which is formed in step 4 will be hydrolyzed to give N-alkyl carbamic acid. In the last step, that is decarboxylation to form amine. So there will be a loss of CO2 from this N-alkyl carbamic acid, which will further form the final product, that is nothing but amine. Applications. Basically, Hoffmann rearrangement is involved for preparation of primary aliphatic and aromatic amines. Okay. So we can prepare different primary amines, either aliphatic or aromatic, using the Hoffmann rearrangement. The various reactions are shown here. That is, we can prepare methylamine, aniline and benzylamine. It is also used for preparation of beta aminopyridine in good yields. Okay. Stereochemistry. It is an intramolecular rearrangement reaction. In this, the migrating group is chiral. Okay. And its configuration is retained. Thus, this rearrangement is intramolecular. Why? Because the migrating group does not become free, but it remains attached with the substrate in some way. So that's why it is called as intramolecular rearrangement. And this intramolecular nature was demonstrated by carrying out the reaction with a mixture of 3-deuteriobenzamide and N15-benzamide. And it was found that mixed anilines could not be isolated using this Hoffmann rearrangement. So this was a proof that Hoffmann rearrangement is an intramolecular rearrangement, and it also indicated that the migrating groups did not separate during the rearrangement reaction. This can be explained with the help of these reactions. Okay, when a mixture of metadeuteriobenzamide and a benzamide N15, they are treated with alkaline chlorine, only two products are found to be produced. That is, there is no cross product is produced. While we would have been formed if the phenyl group from one molecule had become attached to nitrogen of another. If the reaction had been intramolecular, then there would have been cross products such as metadeuterioaniline and aniline. So thank you for patient listening. If you have any doubts, you can contact me on my email address, that is mayureshrao2005@gmail.com. Thank you and happy learning. Namaste, myself Mayuresh Rao, Assistant Professor in Department of Pharmaceutical Chemistry, Sinhagad Institute of Pharmaceutical Sciences, Lonavala. Today, we are going to discuss Hoffmann rearrangement. By the end of this topic, the learner should be able to understand what is Hoffmann rearrangement, the mechanism involved in Hoffmann rearrangement, the applications of Hoffmann rearrangement, and the stereochemistry involved in Hoffmann rearrangement. So what is Hoffmann rearrangement? In Hoffmann rearrangement, there is conversion of amides to amines by action of sodium hypohalite, which is usually generated in C2 by reaction of halogen and NaOH. In Hoffmann rearrangement, the product has one carbon atom less in the molecule than the original amide. Hoffmann rearrangement is an rearrangement of electron deficient nitrogen atom, wherein the rearrangement takes place on the electron deficient nitrogen. The general reaction of Hoffmann rearrangement is shown below, wherein the starting material is amide. It reacts with bromine and base, that is either NaOH or KOH, to give amine. Mechanism. Let us understand the stepwise mechanism which is involved in Hoffmann rearrangement. Step 1 involves abstraction of proton by a base to form intermediate 1. So the base, either NaOH or KOH, will dissociate to form Na plus and OH minus, and this OH minus will react with the amide, or it will abstract the proton of the amide and form intermediate 1, that is RCONH2 will be converted to RCONH. Step 2 is reaction of this intermediate 1 with bromine to form N-bromoamide. So the intermediate 1 reacts with the bromine to form N-bromoamide. The bromine gets attached to the nitrogen, so that's why it is called as N-bromoamide. Step 3 involves loss of proton from the N-bromoamide. So there will be loss of this proton and it will become RCONBr in step 3. Step 4, that is nothing but migration of the R group from the adjacent carbon atom to the nitrogen, leading to formation of isocyanate. In this case, the R can be either alkyl or aryl group. So you can see here, the R group, it is migrating to the nitrogen atom, and at the same time, bromine is leaving, leading to the formation of isocyanate. Step 5 is nothing but the hydrolysis of isocyanate to form carbamic acid. So the isocyanate which is formed in step 4 will be hydrolyzed to give N-alkyl carbamic acid. In the last step, that is decarboxylation to form amine. So there will be a loss of CO2 from this N-alkyl carbamic acid, which will further form the final product, that is nothing but amine. Applications. Basically, Hoffmann rearrangement is involved for preparation of primary aliphatic and aromatic amines. Okay. So we can prepare different primary amines, either aliphatic or aromatic, using the Hoffmann rearrangement. The various reactions are shown here. That is, we can prepare methylamine, aniline and benzylamine. It is also used for preparation of beta aminopyridine in good yields. Okay. Stereochemistry. It is an intramolecular rearrangement reaction. In this, the migrating group is chiral. Okay. And its configuration is retained. Thus, this rearrangement is intramolecular. Why? Because the migrating group does not become free, but it remains attached with the substrate in some way. So, that's why it is called as intramolecular rearrangement. And this intramolecular nature was demonstrated by carrying out the reaction with a mixture of 3-deuteriobenzamide and N15 benzamide, and it was found that mixed anilines could not be isolated using this Hoffmann rearrangement. So this was a proof that Hoffmann rearrangement is an intramolecular rearrangement, and it also indicated that the migrating groups did not separate during the rearrangement reaction. This can be explained with the help of these reactions. Okay, when a mixture of metadeuteriobenzamide and a benzamide N15, they are treated with alkaline chlorine, only two products are found to be produced. That is, there is no cross product is produced. While we would have been formed if the phenyl group from one molecule had become attached to nitrogen of another. If the reaction had been intramolecular, then there would have been cross products such as metadeuterioaniline and aniline. So thank you for patient listening. If you have any doubts, you can contact me on my email address, that is mayureshrao2005@gmail.com. Thank you and happy learning.